It was a great house. Fred was a little kid, and he loved a record by Bill Cosby. It was his comedy record. He would sit on the floor listening to that record over and over and over. He could recite those comedy routines of Bill Cosby by heart. I bet if you ask him today, he could still remember some of them. And that was 60 years ago. We didn't have a television then, so we had to resort to other things. One time the doorbell rang, and it was a delivery person. They brought a piano in, carried it all the way up the front steps from the sidewalk, and then carried it all the way up to the second floor. Your dad had bought a piano for me, and we still have that piano to this day. What a wonderful, thoughtful gift, because we didn't have much money at all. And he thought I would like a piano. He was always very thoughtful that way, getting an unusual gift that he thought something that I'd like. Of course, he batted zero on some of his gifts, but I'd have to take back a sweater or a purse, but the big things really counted. And now I don't know what to do with it when I pass. I think Art, one of the kids, will like it. Our time in Philadelphia was great. Harry studied a lot. He had to. He was going through medical school and then internship and residency. And his livelihood depended on it. After Fred was born, there were a couple years, and then along came Steve. But Steve came very conveniently on during exam week. And the one day that Harry didn't have an exam was the day Steve was born. And he's been a joy ever since. Steve enjoyed playing tricks and being a jokester. And that made life fun. After a little while, a few years, well, actually a year and a half, along came Kathy. I was busy. I had to put the kid in the stroller or in the kid baby carriage and walk the family to the grocery store, buy the groceries, walk back with the groceries in the corner of the baby carriage, because that's the way it was living in the city. Came time for school, and Fred could go to four-year-old kindergarten, but there were two things he had to do in order to go. He had to be able to carry his 5 cent to school for his milk, and he had to be able to tie his shoes, because they didn't have Velcro shoes back then. They had to tie them. What a job it was teaching him to tie his shoes. Steve had a little friend who lived next door to us, a nice little girl, Christy was her name, and she was a carrot head, real cute. We used to go for walks around the block, and I would push Kathy, who was little then, and Steve, and Christy and I would walk around the block. Now this is a city block, so it's fairly good size. And one day we got around exactly opposite our house, and Christy fell down. Well, she had been skipping, and I didn't think too much about it. Little kids do those things. And so I helped her get up, and we continued on around the block and got back to her house. And she kept complaining that her leg hurt. So I told her mother about what had happened when we went around the block. And her mother took the little girl to the doctors. She had broken her leg. Oh, I felt terrible. And I'd had her walking on it. That little girl was in the hospital for several weeks with a broken leg. And there wasn't anything I could do except I'm sorry. Say I'm sorry over and over. It was very sad. So I always was careful then about taking a little friend away from her home for fear something would happen. The kids would play. We had a little tiny place where they could dig in the dirt alongside the house. But these were like row houses in the city, so there wasn't a lot. And you had to go outside and be with them when they were playing, because they couldn't be alone. When Kathy came along, then there were three of them. And I was very busy keeping house, getting Fred to school, because by then he'd learned to walk about six city blocks by himself, 4 year old, with the neighborhood kids going to school. It was quite an event, but that's what everybody did. We couldn't do that in today's world. It wouldn't be safe. When Karen came along, my parents came down to take care of the kids when it was time to go to the hospital. And I began to feel labor pains. And my dad, because Harry was working at the hospital, my dad said he'd take me. So he was very excited, and he got in his car, got it all ready. And I went out to get in the car, and he hung the car bumper up on another car. He couldn't move it. So our car was still there, and I drove to the hospital instead of my dad. Well, Karen came along and she was fine. And my parents were fine watching the kids. After that, I got pregnant with Linda. And by now, Harry was finishing up his residency, and we were going to move. And he was entitled to go to the national conference, and it was going to be in Miami Beach. an exact time that I was due to have Linda. Well, of course, he was honored to be able to go to the conference. And you're never sure when the baby's going to come. So off he went. And I promised him I was not going to call him when the baby came, because he needed to be there. And I was sort of angry inside that he was. But you know what? Everything lucked out. He had a great time at the conference. He got back safely, and I was still carrying Linda. So she came a few days later. So it worked out again. And this time, Harry's mother and stepfather were going to take care of the kids when I was in the hospital. Well, they did. But the stepfather ruined my vacuum cleaner because he didn't think about picking up the things on the floor that were too big to go in the vacuum cleaner. And they got stuck in it. So they weren't as experienced taking care of kids. But it was a hard time taking care of kids, bringing them up. It was snowy in the winter, and it was cold. And you'd get them all bundled up and outside, and then they'd have to go to the bathroom, and you'd have to come in again. And then you go out again, and then their mittens get wet. I'm glad we don't have to do that in California, in Glendale. And we don't have to shovel snow. But I do still like the snow. But just for little times, not big times. Harry had gone to California to visit at Christmas time, when it was snowy at home, and he came out to Southern California to see about a job. Well, you know what happened when he got out here. There was no snow. It was sunny. The weather was great. He got a job offer, so he took it. And he came home and told me we were moving to California. Just like that, he decided. So move we did. It was a hard move. I had to pack. I just had my fifth kid. She was few weeks old, and I had to start packing because we had to be out and settled by in 2 months. I finally got a mover who would move things. Do you know, the only thing that was missing and damaged and moving across the country was they stole my gallon of maple syrup. I never saw it again. It was very difficult to find a place in California. We stayed in a motel for 2 weeks. We couldn't find an apartment with room to rent for 5 kids. We finally had to look at houses, and it was hard to find a house. And we had to ask his dad to help us. That was hard for Harry, because his dad didn't want him to move to California. But ask him, he did. And that was sort of the beginning of the end of his relationship with his dad. His dad only came out to see him once in all the years after that. And then he didn't want to stay here. Harry had to take him to Palm Springs to be warm. But enough about the sad parts, the good parts. The kids loved playing. They could go barefoot outside. We had a neighbor with more kids than we did for them to play with, and a good school for them to go to. Now, Steve loved to play. And when it rained, Steve would walk to school and jump in all the puddles. And then on the way home, he walked in all the puddles. I don't know if Steve's still walking in puddles, but he sure loved it. Pretty soon, Kim came. She's our native Californian. Kim was the only child at home, so she made up a friend named Jane.
Mary.
Mary. I have the wrong name. My memory's not good. And her friend lived up in the Brand Park. And Kim had a wonderful time playing that way. And then one day, she was gone. Kim had grown up. One Thanksgiving, my brother Chuck and his family with three kids came to visit. And we went to Disneyland on Thanksgiving Day. Had a wonderful time and went to the beach. And the kids got in the water. Fred found a snake in Brand Park, and he brought it home, and he came down to the back door and said, "Hey, Mom, see what I found." And it was a huge 5-foot gopher snake. "Can I keep it?" Well, he put it in an aquarium. And it stayed in that aquarium for several seasons. And he fed it white mice. And then we had another baby. Art came along. And Art was in a little room in the back. And one day I went in to get Art up out of his crib, and the snake was on the floor underneath the crib. I was terrified. What if the snake got into the crib with the Art? So what did I do? But I ran out of the room and closed the door so the snake would stay in there. And found Fred and told him to get the snake out of there. Well, the snake did bite him while he was trying to get him, but he got him, and I made him take it back up to the park and get rid of it. It was a horrible experience. So when Art grew up and he was a Boy Scout, and he went to camp. One summer, he caught a snake and he put it in his sleeping bag and he slept with it in the sleeping bag. And you know what he called it? Fred. He wanted to bring Fred the snake home, but they wouldn't let him, thank goodness. But that snake was little, it wasn't big, and it was not a rattlesnake. Fred went to Boy Scout camp. Steve went to Boy Scout camp. But only Art caught a snake at Boy Scout camp. The girls did Girl Scouting, took them to camp. And the whole family has been involved with Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts. And to this day, I'm a life member of Girl Scouts, and I support them wholeheartedly. I don't know what'll happen now that Boy Scouts are going to bring Girl Scouts. That's not for me to worry about. It's hard to say what kinds of stories are best told. To remember the family by. They'll probably remember Christmas. We always have a fresh tree, even though it dies, and I won't put water in the basin. But I like the smell of it and the freshness of it. We always have good stuffing at Thanksgiving. I've taught the kids how to make the stuffing, bread and celery and onions and things. It's a good kind. It was traditional. After Dad died, I had several things changed. Probably the first thing I did after he died was to take down the draperies and curtains in my bedroom, which I had long since ceased to like. And there was something about taking them down that formally opened up a new chapter. Dad was sick for a long time, so I was expecting this, but at some time soon, but not knowing when, of course. But it made me realize that I now had the sole decision making on the house. Or so I thought. I might put it that way, because now it wasn't just Dad and me making life together and making decisions on when we did what or what. But my children were more involved because now they felt they had Mom to take care of. So there were many changes to be made. One of them was financial, and I needed to be sure there were two names or three names on the checkbooks, on the financial things, on the records. There were death certificates to contend with, seeing that those were given out in the proper places. The decisions on the burial had already been made, and so I didn't have any of that to worry about. But minor things. During the day, I found that because I had been involved in numerous community things, I pretty much had activities or entries on my calendar of things to do and the house to take care of, etc. But in the evening, it was quiet. It was lonelier. That's when it hits you. And maybe when you have a big decision to make, you ask one of your kids or several of them in the family about them, whereas before you didn't do that as much. And as time went on, kids became more and more involved. The ones who were close. And I was lucky because five of the seven were close. But then the kids got bigger and older, and their kids got bigger. And they began to develop the kinds of problems and situations that happen during life. And so there were more things to think about. It wasn't just getting them to do their homework, or seeing that they had new shoes, or that they had their activities or their friends. It was real life, big life situations. So there were more things to think about when you're a widow. I don't know if a widow's by herself with nobody, what that might be, because I didn't have that. But I continued to do things. I couldn't drive. I had to take, because of my eyesight, so I had to secure rides. And I had to bolster up my courage, I should say, to drive with different drivers. Because as we got older, the driving skills decrease. And some drivers you don't want to ride with. Or if you do, you only want it a short distance. Or you want to say your prayers before you get in. Or you want to ride in the back seat, not the front seat. Life is different. But having many activities has helped me, because I've had friendships in them. It's not just the activity, it's the friendships. And I've been lucky that way. Had trouble getting known by in Glendale, because it was pretty much a, if you weren't born there, you don't belong kind of community. But I was able to conquer that in time. I've learned that you can't always speak your mind. You have to reserve it. I've learned that sometimes whatever is your decision or your mind might be a little bit wrong or need a little tweaking. And if you haven't spouted out about things, it's much easier to tweak your own mind than if you let everybody in the world know one thing. Then it's hard to change. I've learned that there are a lot of things that happen that you have no control over. You have to learn to accept. You have to learn to give things a little bit of time. And they work out. You have to try. And on relationships, they're not always the rosiest. But you have to keep, have faith and keep trying. I've learned that it's easier not to gain weight, but to maintain what you have. It saves on buying new clothes. It saves on your temperament and your feeling of confidence in yourself. I've learned to let people be different and still be loved. I've learned to let people, because I have 7 kids, each one is different, very different. And I've learned not to try to make them all fit in the same mold, but to love them and give them confidence in what they can do. I've learned to help them when they need help and when they don't want it or want to tell you, you don't pry. I've learned that some colors go to bed together better than others. I've learned that because my dad never wanted my mother to wear green or me to wear green, that there was some reason for it and just to go along with it. But now he's not around, and if I want to wear green, I wear green. I've learned to keep my mouth closed. I've learned that I get cold better, easier than I used to. I've learned it's okay to use a telephone, because when I grew up, the telephone was for my dad's work, and we didn't use it. And there was no chair by the telephone, so you were not as tempted to sit and talk. I've learned I really don't like to go to cocktail parties. I'm not a party person. I've learned that this is a very difficult thing for me to talk about myself for so long, because I never talk about myself. I'm a listener. When I was little, my brother did all the talking for me. They thought I'd never talk when I was a toddler. And he and my mother were the talkers. And that pretty much continued all his life. But I've also learned when I have to talk, I can. So that's why I agreed to do this. But practice makes perfect, but I don't think I'm going to have more practice. I'd like to tell all my children that there are ups and downs in life, and keep faith in your loved ones, because things do work out. And keep in touch with everybody, because blood is thicker than water lots of times.
With every